This video is related to part two of lecture five. If we go to the overview of lecture five, we wanted to talk about wide band channel measurement systems. I gave you an introduction and time domain measurement systems using pulse transmission in the first video of this course. So in the introduction, I was giving you the overview of like wideband channel measurements. And then for pulse transmission techniques, I just discussed the techniques that we want to measure the impulse response of the channel. We send a very narrow pulse periodically. And the width of that narrow pulse should be much smaller than multipath spread that I want to measure. And repetition of the pulses should be more than multipath spread that I want to measure. Basically, that was the trick. That was the only calculation that I needed to do for measurements. Also, I had another parameter, if you remember, that was related to like how many times I can average. Basically, my measurement time means the time that it takes that I do the measurements, okay, should be like less than half of the Doppler spread of the channel so that I can sample the channel properly. So if my Doppler spread is like 10 hertz, I have to sample the channel like twice that, which is like at 20 hertz. So my measurements are good to be like 1 over 20 hertz, which is 5 milliseconds, something like that. Okay? That's my measurement time. Because in that period, channel is not changing. It's relatively constant. Okay? So I want to measure the channel so that it is constant during the time. That's one way to do it, actually. So now, when I do measurements, since I'm sending a pulse repeated in time, so on the scope, more or less, I get the same thing. So if I average on the scope, all of these digital scopes, they have averaging capabilities. So if I average like 10 times, my signal-to-noise ratio improves 10 times. And we refer to that averaging like processing gain. Okay. So I take like, if the channel is not changing and I have repetition, I do the averaging. And then I told you one more thing. One way is if I have a mobile application and I want to do the measurement, usually for wideband characteristics, we stay in one location. We do the measurements. Usually we do that. We don't have mobile because it takes some time to like set up everything. But if I have non-mobile, and let's say my measurement system takes like 1 second to do the measurements, if I want to like do the measurement, then I come on the weekends in the area so that nobody is around. So I put my transmitter receiver, and during my measurement, I don't let anybody move close to them. Okay? So even if I go, and then I can do more averaging. So there is like some games that I can play in order to improve my signal-to-noise ratios. But most of the wideband measurements that we do really, for wideband measurements, usually we keep the signal-to-noise ratio very high. Because we have a bunch of like paths arriving, and we want them to be above the background noise. So that when the background noise comes up, many of the paths, they go under, and we don't get the characteristics. So when you do wideband measurements, often you try to have very high signal-to-noise ratios. But when I want to cover longer distances, then at those edges, I want to improve the signal-to-noise ratio. So when I do the measurements, when I'm close by, I don't do the averaging. When I go to bad locations, okay, location that signal-to-noise ratio comes down, I stop and I do some averaging. I don't let anybody move. So these are just basic common engineering, like intuition for doing measurements. Now with that, I'm talking about pulse transmission. Huh? I send a pulse periodic, like we had like things of this nature. I'm sending these pulses periodic, and then I receive the multipaths like this, repeated, one after another. Okay? And last week we send physically the pulse, and physically we receive the multipath. This week I want to talk about another way to produce these pulses. That other way is using direct sequence spread spectrum technique. The difference between this direct pulse transmission and direct sequence spread spectrum is that in here, when I'm transmitting the signal, suddenly I have a very high peak. In a spread spectrum, you can think about it that I'm spreading this peak all over the time with low amplitude. See, in here I have a very high peak, and then I have zeros. In a spread spectrum system, all the time I have very constant envelope. Okay? And how does it work? I will tell you. But that I will show you that a spread spectrum system is a system equivalent to pulse transmission system, with the difference that I'm not sending pulses really. I'm sending pulses, but not very narrow pulses with high peaks. I'm sending very short pulses, but with low peaks. And then at the receiver, I get all of these low peaks, I put them on top of one another, I reconstruct a pulse. That's the trick. Okay? So basically, I have little munchkins, small square pulses that I send in here. And suddenly at the receiver, I process them, I put them on top of one another, I create a pulse like this. That is measurement system using direct sequence spread spectrum. So the first step is just to explain to you what is direct sequence spread spectrum and how I use it as a pulse transmission technique. This discussion is very helpful, actually, to understand direct sequence spread spectrum and any sort of spread spectrum technique. Okay? Then, second part of that, I will talk about using a sliding correlator as a receiver to implement direct sequence spread spectrum for measurement systems. And that is also a very important, in fact, concept, because a lot of receivers, like in Bluetooth, they use sliding correlators. Okay. Anybody who does time synchronization, they use a sort of a sliding correlator somewhere. Okay, so for GPS, they use a sliding correlators. So we see that particular receiver. So the content of what I'm telling you is under wideband channel measurement systems, but in reality, I'm giving you an introduction to direct sequence spread spectrum system. And one of its applications, which is in wideband channel measurement. But the result of channel measurements are very similar to the results that we observed earlier with pulse transmission techniques, because these are identical systems that just implemented differently. Okay? So let's just go and see what is direct sequence spread spectrum and how do I interpret that as a pulse transmission technique, and then see what is a sliding correlator. This is basically concept of direct sequence spread spectrum that is based on, like, when I want to send a symbol, let's say in pulse transmission, I want to send just like a pulse with an amplitude of 1, let's say. Rather than sending that with that amplitude, I will send a bunch of narrow pulses with polarity of plus and minus 1. Okay? Now, so I have a bunch of small pulses that I call them chips. In here, I have the chips taking value of 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, suddenly goes minus 1, then I have 1, 1, 1, suddenly they goes to minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, again 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, again minus 1, minus 1. Okay, and this, the whole thing that I have in here is one symbol. And if I want to represent this symbol is f of t, which is summation a bunch of random number, b sub I, which are either plus or minus, and a pulse shape, which is an square. Okay? So I have a sequence of number, b sub I, which are like 1, 1, 1, 1, and then minus 1, and then 1, 1, and then minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, for example. Okay? And then for each of these bits, for each of these chips, I send like a square pulse. So I'm forming like a pulse shape which comes like this. So this is my basic pulse shape. Let's see if I can do it better in here. This is my basic pulse shape. That's my p sub t. And b sub i's are like plus and minus. So the first one, this is plus, for example. I put this, second one plus, third one plus, fourth one plus, plus, then it's minus, then it's plus, plus, then it's minus, 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 then again plus, 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 and then let's say minus and minus. Something like that. Okay? So these are values of b sub I. Plus 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1. Now, and this whole thing is my f of t, which is my symbol, which replaces that pulse that I used to send for time domain. Do you remember what I was sending in time domain? For time domain measurements, rather than this sequence of chips, I was sending a very sharp pulse like this. That's what I was sending before in pulse transmission technique. Instead of sending one narrow pulse, I'm sending these chips like this. Okay? Then for the next one, rather than again sending the rather than sending the second pulse, instead of the second pulse, again I send another set of chips. Okay. Now, the only thing that I do is, like, now, so I'm sending these chips one after another. Now, the way that I select these chips, these are called PN sequence. And PN doesn't mean positive, negative. It means pseudo random. Means it's dummy random. What is the meaning of dummy random? The meaning of dummy random is that if I take these numbers, plus 1, the sequence that I have in here, let's say plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, and then let's minus 1, minus 1, and then another plus 1, and this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 is another minus 1. Okay? Let's say I have like 7 bits. This is B1, B2, up to B7. Okay? I select these chips using coding theory so that when I do the autocorrelation function of this thing, I end up with something like always, let's say minus 1, and then I have one value which goes at the beginning or at the end, which is 7. What? This is what happens. These are the sequence of numbers. If I want to find the autocorrelation function of this, cyclic autocorrelation function, I just multiply the sequence by itself. Okay? So it's plus 1, plus 1, plus 1. If I multiply it by itself, minuses multiplies with that. Okay? So I have plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1. If I multiply all of these things together, I have what? I have like 1, 1, 1, minuses are 1, 1. Either if plus or minus is 1. And if I add all of these things together, I will have 7. Okay? Now if I shift this thing, this sequence, I shift it once. Then I have like plus 1, plus, plus, and then this plus comes in here, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, everything is shifted. Okay? And then I have minus 1, minus 1, plus 1, and this last minus 1 is cyclic, comes back to here, minus 1, this last one, because I'm considering a cyclic, like shift. Now I look at that, plus times minus is minus, minus is minus, minus minus is plus, and then plus minus is minus 1, plus plus is plus 1, plus plus is plus 1, and then minus minus is minus 1. So if I now add them up, this cancels with this, this cancels with this, this cancels with this, I end up to minus 1. So this, like sliding and multiplying, is called what? Autocorrelation function. This is autocorrelation function of what? Of these two sequences. This sequence is called a PN sequence. If I select these things so that my autocorrelation function is 7, for one shift it's minus 1, for two shift is minus 1, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, this is my autocorrelation function in digital format. Okay? Did you follow that? Most of you may have seen that like in other places. This is just a review. But this PN sequence, now in direct sequence spread spectrum, like format, is like this thing. If I come back and erase everything. Now, in terms of pulses, I have the same, like PN sequence plus minus ones from here to here, but rather than sending plus minus, I'm sending a square pulses. What will happen if I do that? If I do that, actually, what will happen is that my autocorrelation function, so rather than I had this thing, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, plus 1, and minus 1. That was the sequence that I had. If I want to put it with square pulses, it's 3 of them like this. Okay? And then I have 2 minus 1s. Then I have 1 plus 1. I have to... 1 plus 1 and 1 minus 1. Okay, so this is minus, this is plus, minus, minus, plus, plus, plus. This is the sequence that I have with pulses. Okay, now if I find the autocorrelation function of this thing, this autocorrelation function would look like this. Which, if I repeat it, would look like this. Because what will happen is that if I, for example, shift this thing one time to the right, this pulse comes like, I mean, remember, it's repeated. This plus turns now negative. This comes like this. Then comes like this. Then goes like this. Then goes like this. If I multiply these two together and integrate them, find the area under it, it ends up to be zero. Oh, I mean minus one. See, if I multiply these two together, in here I have minus one. The area is minus one because this is plus, this is minus. In here, here is plus, so I have two pluses. In here is plus minus, I have minus. In here plus minus, I have minus. In here I have plus times minus, sorry. This is again minus. And then at the end in here, I have repetition of the 1 and minus 1. Am I doing the correct thing now? This is like minus minus. In here it's going to be plus. This is minus minus. In here is plus, sorry. And then I have like three minuses. So I have 1 minus area, 1 is plus and plus 2, and then I have minus, and then I have plus, and then I have another 1 at the end, which is a minus. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then I have another 1 at the end, which is also minus. Okay? So the area, the total area in here, is these are positive areas canceling these negative areas, and leftover is one negative area, unit of negative area. Follow me? So if I go by digit, actually, in here, 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 I have minus one for my autocorrelation function. In here, I have 7. Because when they are aligned, everything is positive. Is 7 unit of area. Okay. In between, this is, what is the autocorrelation function of a box? It's a triangle. Okay? So it comes like this, and it comes like this. If you autocorrelate two boxes, autocorrelation function of box with box is what? Do you remember that from your signal courses? It's a triangle. So in between it's like this triangle because I have partial coverage between them. So if I come to the autocorrelation function, the autocorrelation function coming back to this figure would be something like that, which are pulses which are repeating themselves every how much? You're repeating themselves from here to here, which is, if the number of these chips is n, and duration of this chip is tc, then between here and here is ts equal to n times tc. Make sense? Okay. So, if I have this repetitive PN sequence pulses, and at the receiver I pass them through an autocorrelation function or autocorrelation implementation of autocorrelation. Somehow I have to implement it. I don't know how yet. But if I can implement the autocorrelation function at the receiver, then output of the autocorrelator is something like this, this peaks. But remember, in order to do the autocorrelation function, I have to get the signal, multiply it by what? I have to take the signal, multiply it with its shifted version, take one integral. Then I change this tau, I do another integral. Then I change the tau, I do another integral. I mean, for each point, I have to do a complete integral. Do you follow me? Autocorrelation is a parametric integral. So for any value of this parameter theta, tau, I have to do the original signal x of t, which in my case is actually f of t. This is this one multiplied with shifted version of that and integrated between 0 to ts from here to here. Okay? And usually I put a normalization factor of 1 over ts in front of that. I normalize it with the period of time. This is definition, mathematical definition of what I was telling you so far. This x is actually this f. Okay? Now, if I put, like, rather than f, I put this thing, which is summation of these Munchkins, x is f of t repeated. I mean, periodic form of the f of t. Okay. Now, then I end up the autocorrelation. If I get the autocorrelation, which is x of t multiplied x of t minus tau, if I take this integral, this is equivalent to n over ts rpp, which is the autocorrelation function of this Munchkin's square wave, tau minus nts. Nts is this period that is repeating. Rpp of tau is this, which is really, if I call this Munchkin's p of t, this is p of t convolved with p of t. Okay, so no matter what is this pulse shape, if this pulse shape in my case is a square, okay, if I want, and I have a set of like chip values, like plus minus ones, which they have an autocorrelation function like this. I mean, digital autocorrelation function like this. Minus one, minus one, minus one, minus one, and then suddenly goes seven. Okay? Then, if I want to find the autocorrelation function of the analog form of that using these pulses, I end up with something like this. The peak of this one is how much? Is n divided by ts. Shape of this pulse is actually autocorrelation function of this pulse. And that's what I see in this math in here. RPP is autocorrelation function or convolution of the pulse by itself, this pulse by itself, p of t and p of t minus tau, which is this triangle, and rx, x of tau, which is my autocorrelation function, is this convolution repeated every ts. Okay? This is the key to understanding of direct sequence spread spectrum. If it was a communication system, for example, when this bit is 1, I will send everything with this polarity. When it's minus 1, I send reverse polarity, so I receive something like this. And at the receiver, I detect this, I will say it was a 1 transmitted. If I detect this, I say minus 1 was transmitted. But when I'm doing like measurement systems, I only send ones all the time because I want to see what will happen to the pulse. Okay? But the beauty of this thing is that what I showed you was if I use a direct sequence spread spectrum system and transmit these pulses with pseudo-random manner, at the receiver, I take these pulses and I correlate them somehow with the same pulses, I will end up at the output of the correlator get these peaks like this. These peaks like that. Okay? This is what I'm doing with a spread spectrum system. So in another word, if I want to now have like a receiver, for example, for this, I can sketch like a receiver for this whole thing and tell you this thing, that at the transmitter, you just take these pulses, pulse generator, this piece of T's. Just this piece of T's are coming every TC second. And then I multiply them with B sub I's. You remember what are the B sub I's? Those munchkins, little plus minus ones, like it's plus one, plus one, plus one, minus one. What was the code that I used? Minus one, plus one, minus one, and then repeats itself. Okay, this is the sequence that I call it PN sequence. So this looks like a binary communication using the chips. So I do that, and then I put it on an RF, I mean whatever, radio frequency I multiply, modulate it on an RF signal, like FC. And then I have an antenna, I send it. Okay. At the receiver, I multiply this with the FC and pass it through a filter. Then the baseband signal comes out. Then this baseband signal in here was the sequence, repeated itself, repeating itself. In here, I have the same thing, the same signal, three pluses, two minuses, one plus, one minus, repeating itself. This is what I get in here after low band. The baseband signal is the same as this baseband signal that I was sending in here. And it repeats itself. Now, when I receive this thing at the receiver, I put a correlator. I don't know how to implement it, but I put a correlator in here. What does correlator do? Takes this received signal, repeat it. This repeated signal is x of t. It multiplies this received signal with x of t minus tau and integrates that between 0 and ts, and so that would be like my output. I mean, if I put an integrator in here, 1 over Ts, the output would be something like this. Okay? This correlator, the way that I have implemented in here, is a multiplier in here followed by an integrator between 0 and Ts. And the output is this thing. Okay, so if I forget about this front end, like I forget about this one and this one, these are like modulating to higher frequency and bringing to lower frequency, let's get that away. In reality, even simpler than that, this is what I have. At transmitter, my pulses are coming, P of T's, they are multiplied with this B sub I's, which are plus minus one. They go to an antenna. At the receiver, this antenna comes, I mean, I deleted the RF part in the baseband, okay? I will multiply them now. This time, I have received the signal. I multiply it by, what I have in here is x of t. What I have in here, I have x of t. I multiply it with x of t minus tau. I pass it through an integrator between 0 Ts and factored 1 over Ts, okay? This is integral of x of t minus tau d tau, okay? The output in here is going to be my autocorrelation function. Very nice block diagram. But remember, this is R x of tau. Is not T. And if you want to do this thing, you have to repeat this thing for different values of tau. Okay, so calculation of this thing is not that easy. Because if it's x of T minus tau, I integrate it for one value of tau. That's just one point in here. I have to calculate it for all of these points, for samples of this. Do you follow me? this integral that I have in here, 1 over Ts, integral of 0 Ts, is x of t times x of t minus tau d tau. This is what I call it R x x of tau. This is a parametric integral. Sorry, this is d of t. I have to calculate it for different values of tau. Okay? How can I calculate it for different? For any value of tau I calculate it, I calculate one point of this autocorrelation function. Do you see the point? And that's where a sliding correlator comes to the picture. So this thing that I say in here is only a mathematical concept. Implementation of this mathematical concept, it has to be implemented for different values of tau. And I have to have a device to do that. That device is a sliding correlator. Okay? So if you want to summarize, clean it up. What I told you so far was that if you have, I mean, this is like clean up version of what I said before I tell you what is a sliding correlator. I mean, I told you that like in pulse transmission techniques, I was sending these pulses like piece of T. I mean, this now I'm using the piece of T in a different context, but that's fine. If I was sending a pulse like this, okay, like a rectangular pulse, every Ts second, I was receiving the same thing. This was pulse transmission technique. Is that right? That was the pulse transmission technique that we started our story. I was sending the pulse repeatedly, and I was receiving the pulses repeatedly. Okay? In a spread spectrum system, rather than sending the pulses, now I'm sending what? I'm sending PN sequences like this and repeat them. This is what I'm sending. Okay? But at the receiver, I take this, this signal, which I call it x of t, I pass it through autocorrelation function calculator, which we call it like correlator. Output of this thing is like that. And this one I call it what? This is, I call it processing. So I receive these PN sequences, I process them with a correlator, okay? And I will get the same thing as I was getting in here. So in another word, direct sequence spread spectrum is a sort of pseudo or virtual pulse transmission technique, isn't it? Because the received signal after processing in here is equivalent to the received signal in pulse transmission technique. So in a spread spectrum system, when I receive the signal, I pass it through a correlator. I get these peaks repeated. In pulse transmission, what I receive is exactly the same thing. Now, what was the difference? So what? So what is that? In the transmitter side, earlier I was sending these narrow pulses with high peaks, and then I had nothing in between. So my power had ups and lows, ups and downs. In here, I'm sending the same power all the time. So my amplifier doesn't need to have a very wide range. It should be only accurate for these amplitudes. And that's a much easier thing to be implemented. Okay? So this one is much better in terms of implementation. Because I have a more efficient power amplifier at the end. So I can cover more distances. And but really, truly, when they use this thing, this technique, direct sequence, a spread spectrum was done for military application. The ratio of this peak to this peak is what? Like n. So if I'm just sending pulses from one location to another location, people look at that and they see it. In here, if I make this n, which is the length of my PN sequence, if I make it very, very large, my amplitude becomes very small and nobody can detect me. That's why in military they were using it. But for us, it has a different meaning. Okay? For us, there is not much of a difference except that the amplifier is better. I mean, it's used more efficiently. But in the military, I can hide the signal. Okay? Now, why do they call it a spread spectrum? Because in the military, really, rather than sending pulses like this, actually they're sending bits. And we will see that later. Let me just don't get into that now. Let me just keep that for the later on. Just stay with what I was so far. But you followed so far. So a spread spectrum system, rather than sending pulses, actually cuts the pulse into small pulses, sends them at the receiver. Really, this correlator puts those little things on top of one another and creates these peaks, if you want to have an intuition about it. Huh? But receiver knows that whenever it's negative, it multiplies with a negative pulse. Whenever it's positive, again multiplies with a positive pulse. So builds it on top of one another and keeps the peak. On the other hand, this pulse transmission technique is identical to direct sequence. They are identical in terms of receive signal. So if I have a multipath environment, I send these things, I receive several paths. Okay, in here, I send these things, I receive several correlations, like this. So I can use it for what? Channel measurement. But my receiver needs to do correlation function. How do I implement this correlator? Okay, that correlator is the so-called sliding correlator that I talk about it. But up to now, what I showed you was a spread spectrum, direct sequence spread spectrum system, which is basically you take a bunch of little chips with different polarities or plus minus random polarities, and I'm sending those pulses one after another. At the receiver, if I have a good autocorrelation function, if I can calculate the autocorrelation function, I get received pulses like that, which are very similar to what I would have received with pulse transmission. But in here, I have sent very low peak power. In here, I have very high peak power. Okay, at this time, I have to have a very high peak power. In here, always I have low peak power. Okay, so it's more efficient to send it like this. Okay, so up to here I had this thing. Does it make sense? Do you have any questions about it? We come back to this issue later on when we talk about direct sequence spread spectrum. But what we carry from here is that using PN sequences, we can create an environment which is useful for measurements of the multipath components of the channel. Okay? Means I send one path, one pulse, I receive several pulses, represented bounced packs, bounced signal from different objectives. Okay? Now, the only thing that I want is this thing, how to do the correlator. Now, so in multipath environment, I already told you, we send like these pulses, repeated pulses. When I get the correlation function, I get several pulses. I already told you this one. So I can get a channel profile, very similar to channel profiles that I had earlier. I can get it in here. Like earlier, if you remember in pulse transmission, I was sending like pulses and I was receiving these things. I can do exactly the same thing with a spread spectrum system. Samples of that, I can show you. These are some samples. These are some samples of channel impulse response with a spread spectrum system. They do identical things. Okay. Now, I want to go to the issue of a sliding correlator. So, to go to the sliding correlator, this is like a figure that I already gave you in a sense. I told you I take the signal and these are the pulses which are coming in, and then I form x of t by multiplying that by bi equal to plus minus 1s, and then I modulate them, amplifier, and then I send it out. And then I say that the receiver, what I do, I have an amplifier, I take like, I mean, this amplifier, and then I have FC multiplied with this. After that, I'm going to have a sort of like correlator. This is my correlator. Correlator. A sliding correlator operates like this. Rather than multiplying with RC, which is the rate of chips, I multiply it with RC minus delta R. Means that I had these chips, which I was transmitting like this, 3 plus 1, 2 minus 1, 1 plus 1, 1 minus 1. I was repeating this thing. Huh? This distance from here to here was TC. Inverse of that was RC, which is 1 over TC. What I do is that at the receiver, rather than I multiply this thing with the exact thing, I multiplied with a thing which is a little bit shorter than this. Just a little bit shorter than this. Little bit shorter than this. I mean, the data rate is a little bit shorter than this. So, or a little bit longer than this. So when this one finishes, this guy has already finished. Or the other way around. Do you follow me? But that's the same pattern. That's the same pattern. But there is a distance between them, like delta t. Okay? How do I create that distance? Inverse of this thing is this delta r. Okay? Now, if I want to do autocorrelation, what should I do? I have to take this signal, like x of t, multiply it with this thing, which is x of t, if I start them at the same time. This is almost roughly x of t. Is that right? And then I have to integrate that over here to here. From here to here, I have to integrate it. This is over Ts. Huh? Now, if I make this thing a little bit slower, just a little bit slower, what will happen to that integral? It stays almost the same. Is that right? But what will happen is that at the end in here, I'm delta t apart. So at the end, right in here or in here, I have like autocorrelation function rxx evaluated approximately at zero. Then I have second cycle of integral. When I start the second cycle, these two are delta t apart. So in the next cycle, what I will calculate would be rxx of delta t. In the next one, I will have rxx of 2 delta t. Do you follow me? The rate of transmission of these chips are different, equivalent to delta R. The meaning of that in time is that when one of them is Ts, the other one is delta T less than Ts or delta T more than Ts. That makes sense. Is that right? So, at the beginning when I start, both of them are aligned. And I take the integral is roughly Rxx0, means that the two signals are right on top of one another. But in the second cycle, they are delta t apart. So what I calculate is Rxx of delta t. In the third cycle, it's Rxx of 2 delta t. So in a sense, each TS time, I'm calculating one sample of RxX of 0, RxX of tau. So I start in here. At the beginning, I have calculated RxX of 0. Then TS second after that, I have since calculated RxX of delta T. I have two time. One is computation time. One are samples of autocorrelation function. These are samples of autocorrelation function, which are delta T apart. And I'm calculating that each sample takes how much time to calculate? TS second. Okay? So in another word, what I'm doing is like this. I have this PN sequence, and I have this other PN sequence. These two PN sequences, they are like so much different from one another. In this time, this is like that delta T that I said. In here, I have called it tau sub S. They are so much apart from one another. Okay, I multiply these two together. I multiply this with this, and I integrate over 0 to TS. What did I calculate? I have calculated like X of T almost multiplied with X of T theta. And what is X of T multiplied with X of T? And 1 over TS in here. This is nothing but X R autocorrelation function at location 0. So if I want to sketch autocorrelation function, that's this value that I have. Do you follow me? If you didn't, I will go to sketch something for you. Well, actually, in here I can tell you. See, what is the definition of our autocorrelation function? Rxx of tau. What is this? This is equal to 1 over Ts, integral of 0 Ts, x of t minus, times x of t minus tau, theta, dt. Isn't it? What is the meaning of that? Means I multiply these two, 4, x of t is this pulse, x of t minus tau is this pulse shifted for tau. Huh? That's the autocorrelation function. Now, what I do is that this is roughly x of t. What is this guy? This is also roughly x of t. I mean, if this is x of t, this is roughly x of t, because I changed it just a little bit. Huh? So if I multiply these two and integrate, I have integral of x of t times x of t. Means that I have assumed that tau is equal to 0. So the integral that I take is this integral for the value of 0 for tau. Okay? For 0 tau. For tau equal to 0. Okay? So if I calculate this integral for tau equal to 0, means that I have calculated this thing in Rx of tau. This is Rxx of tau. For tau equal to 0 is this one. Okay, now let me just go and sketch it. So this is a signal I have, like, okay, this is a signal that I have, which is repeating itself. Now, while it is repeating itself, first time I'll multiply it with a little bit larger version of this. At the end in here, these two are delta T or tau S apart. This is X of T. What is this? This is also roughly X of T. So if I calculate the integral Rxx of whatever, I'm calculating this integral, 1 over Ts integral of 0 Ts x of t times x of t dt. What is this thing? This is Rx x of 0, because Rx x of tau was defined as 1 over Ts integral of 0 Ts x of t minus tau dt. Okay? So look at that. And this, you compare these two, this is nothing but Rx x0. So I have calculated the first point. My autocorrelation function is this thing. This is my autocorrelation. I know that. Answer is this. So first one, I have calculated this sample. Now, at the end of this pulse, now they are Ts apart. I mean, so much apart. So the signal which comes in here now, top one still is x of t, but the signal this time is x of t minus tau s, or that delta t that I have. So the second integral that I'm calculating in the next period is 1 over ts integral of 0 ts, this time x of t multiplied with x of t minus this tau sub s dt. What is this thing? Comparing with this, what is this? This is autocorrelation function for tau sub s. So the second thing that I have calculated is something like tau s apart is in here. Make sense? Now I go for the third one, not two signal or two tau sub s apart, so I get this thing. I get this thing, this thing, this thing, this thing. Each thing that I calculate is a sample of autocorrelation function which is tau sub s apart from the previous one. So in reality, I'm calculating the autocorrelation function in discrete form with samples which are tau sub s apart. Now, to calculate one of these samples, how long would it take? How much I have to wait? I have to wait from 0 to Ts. So in real time, each measurement takes how much? Ts second. But I'm calculating in imaginary time a sample of autocorrelation function which is tau s apart. So if I now do this sample, 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 I come to here, I'm all set. Is that right? Because I have one full period of autocorrelation function. Is that right? Do you follow me? I take these samples, I can come back now to like to where I was. Now, see, I do one cycle, I calculate this. I calculate one sample. Then I do second sample, I calculate this one, second sample. Now, then I'm doing other samples. So sample by sample, it's saving, it takes some time to get live. Now, I'm calculating these samples. When I did one full period, I have the complete autocorrelation function. Okay? Now, each of these things took me Ts second. The distance between two samples are tau sub s. If I have total of like m samples, then it took me m times Ts seconds to calculate one autocorrelation function. See, I'm sending one symbol for Ts, it takes m times more to calculate the autocorrelation function. But it's very easy to implement. To implement it, it's very easy. I have this what? I have this sliding correlator. Means that at the receiver, rather than multiplying by exactly the same PN sequence, I'm multiplying that with a shifted PN sequence. Okay? This thing is called a sliding correlator. Now, we can do a little bit more calculations on that now, to put it on the equations. So what will happen, what is happening in here, is like I'm calculating the received signal, which is estimate of transmitted signal. Okay, first sample is R0, and this is a sample of autocorrelation function. Then, at the end of that, if TS, this TS is the extra time, which takes for me to compute, minus the TS, which was the period, can be calculated from here. I had n chips at the rate of RC minus delta. I had n chips at the rate of RC. You remember, this TS is the period that, let me just bring it back in here. TS is from here to here. One full period at the receiver. Capital TS is one full period at the transmitter. And they are a little bit different because the rate of this one is what? Rate of this one is R minus delta. Rate of this is just R. Okay? And in here and in here, in both places, I have how many chips? I have n chips. If I have n chips, rate in here is RC, so n divided by RC means like, which is equal to n times TC. That's the time that I have. This is this time, TS. TS equals to n times TC, which is the same as n divided by RC. Is that right? Now, the TS, a small TS, is n over what? RC minus delta C, because the rate of this one is RC minus delta C. You follow me? And I have n chips and n chips for both of them. So if I come, I want to know the difference in time between these two, which I called it like something like tau of S. This is the distance in time between these two, this distance. Sorry, I called this thing delta T, I believe, earlier. Deltas of T. Now, deltas of T, which is the difference between TS and T sub S, is like TS, which is N chips, divided by their rate, which is RC minus delta T. And then T sub S, which is N divided by RC. Make sense? This is the period at the receiver. This is the period at transmitter. At transmitter, my rate is RC. At receiver is RC minus delta R. And for both of them, I have what? N chips. If I put them together in here and I do the calculations, I will end up to this thing equals to delta R times TS divided by RC. Okay? So what will happen is that when I'm taking the samples of autocorrelation function, each sample is this much around. This is that tau of S that I was telling you. Tau of S is delta R times TS divided by RC. So I'm calculating really delta R times TS divided by RC. First sample, second sample, third sample, etc. Okay? So my delta S, which were the samples of this calculated autocorrelation function, distance between two samples of autocorrelation function, this one is delta R times TS divided by R. Now, how many samples it takes? If from here to here is T sub S, and difference between the samples are tau sub S, number of samples in here, which is this K, is TS over tau sub S. Okay? Which if I put these numbers, instead of toss of s in there, I get this thing. So k, which are the number of samples that I calculate, are rc divided by delta r times ts divided by this other ts. How much is the measurement time? Measurement time was this t sub s, which was one period, times k samples. If I put these numbers instead, I end up with this thing. So now I have some like numbers which are not bad actually. In particular, there are two numbers that I like very much, this one and this one. This thing is what? This number that I have in here is this distance between the samples. What is this TM? This on my measurement time. Okay? So let me just record this too, if I want. In summary, if I want to put the summary in here, do I have summary? Yeah, I have the summary in here. That's better. So in summary, this is what I have. I have this periodic signal, PN sequence. I'm repeating that. Autocorrelation at the receiver is something like this, which repeats every TS second. This is one thing that we know. If I use a sliding correlator, means that at the transmitter, I have a chip rate of TC equals to 1 over RC, and at the receiver, I have a chip rate of 1 over RC minus delta C, delta R. Then, as I showed you in the previous stage, I'm going to get samples of this. These samples are tau S apart, and then tau S equals to delta R, which was this difference in the things, times TS, which is roughly equal to capital TS. They are almost the same, divided by RC, my chip rate. This is roughly equal to that. That's just a little bit smaller than that. This is my tau sub s. How many samples do I take? I take so many samples. RC divided by delta R times TS over TS. How about the time that it takes to compute is K times TS, which is RC over delta R times TS. So I have all of these numbers. Then I can do calculations, for example. I plug in numbers. For example, one particular measurement system which was used by Baltitude early days of indoor radio channel modeling around 1988, something like that. He was using RC equal to 40 megahertz, the chip rate. Delta R like 4 kilohertz. How much is the difference between them? 40 megahertz is my chip rate. This is only 4 kilohertz, which is like 1% of that. No, less than 1%. 40 megahertz, 1% of... No, it's much less than that, actually. This is 10,000 times less. Is that right? 40 megahertz is 40,000 divided by 4. 40,000 divided by 4 kilohertz. This is 40,000 kilohertz divided. So the ratio is 10,000 times. So I have drifted that only 4 kilohertz, a little bit. And the frequency is 1. And then number of samples that we that he has, N, these are number of chips, not sample. Chips are 1024. For such a thing, your autocorrelation function, which is something like this, the base of this one is how much? The base of this is 2 See, I had the boxes. The distance of the box was TC. This is twice that TC. Do you follow me? Because I had square pulses with TC, autocorrelation of function of that is twice as much. So it's 2 TC, it's 50 nanosecond. So pulses are 50 nanosecond apart. And this is coming only from what? From the bandwidth. I mean from the chip rate, RC. Okay, for RC of 40 megahertz, okay, 1 over RC is 1 over 40 megahertz. 2 over RC is 1 over 20 megahertz, which is 50 nanosecond. That's the width of my pulses. My TS is what? The period between two of these guys, from here to here. This TS is, I have N chips divided by RC, or which is the same as N times TC. Okay, it'll end up to be 25.6 microseconds. This is how the pulses are repeated. Okay, measurement time, TM. Measurement time, if you calculate it from the equations that we gave in the last page, would end up to 256 milliseconds. Okay, and K, which was the number of samples of this thing, is 10,000, which is roughly the ratio of these two, the same 10,000 that I had in there. Okay? So it's a very simple way to calculate that. Y is roughly equal to, like, bandwidth, I mean, RC divided by thing, because these two are almost the same, I told you. These two are almost the same. This is almost one. So K is RC over what? Delta R. Okay? Now, so it's 10,000. Now, so basically this is what we have. And now, the peak of this thing is 1023 above, because it's n times more than one chip. Okay, so that would give you another, like, extra margin that they call it processing gain. Okay, now this is more or less what we want to do. The calculations, basically, if I come in here based on these equations, calculations are rather simple in a sense. You have, like, RC over delta C is K, inverse of that is cos of S, in a sense. TS times RC times that is, like, what I have. And my measurement time is K times TS, or it be calculated from this. So if somebody gives me this and somebody gives me this, which in my example, this was 4 megahertz, this was 40 megahertz, this was 4 kilohertz, and then I can calculate almost everything in there. Okay? And N, if they give me N. N is sort of, I mean, is related to TS. TS equals to N times TC. Okay? So, based on that, I can calculate three important parameters. One is the distance between the samples. One is number of samples. And one is the measurement time. And in the particular example that I gave you, and base of the pulses also I have given. The base of the pulse is 2 TC, 50 nanosecond. Then TS, which is my period, is like 25.6 microsecond. That's the repetition of the pulses. And then I have, like, measurement time, which is 256 milliseconds, and I have 10,000 samples. Okay? Now, this sliding correlator, in summary, gives you measurements like this, like this. These are typical measurements using a particular sliding correlator. These are the ones that I gave you the specs in here. Okay. So the base of the pulse is around, like, base of the pulse was 50 nanoseconds. They are repeated for, where am I? They are repeated every TS 25.6 microseconds. Okay, so I can calculate a lot of multipath spread with that. And number of samples, resolution is like 10,000 samples, which is very nice in here. And these are results of measurement. Now, so in summary, what I told you in this part of the lecture, I told you that you can use a spread spectrum systems, direct sequence spread spectrum, for channel measurement. If you use direct sequence spread spectrum for channel measurement, it's really you're sending a bunch of PN sequences, and then what you do is that you're sending these PN sequences. Let me just erase this. You're sending these PN sequences repeatedly, and then autocorrelation at the receiver is like peaks of these things. What is the use of that? You can measure the multipath, like here. Again, if I erase it. So I send these repeated pulses, or PN sequences, and then at the receiver I receive things like that, and I can see it on the scope or store it somewhere, which is my multipath profile. Now, how do I implement this? I use a sliding correlator. A sliding correlator basically is a very simple receiver like this. My regular receiver was that I was sending a PN sequence, modulate it and amplifying and send it. In here, I demodulate it by multiplying with FC, and I have the same amplifier. But rather than multiply it exactly with the same correlator, I multiply it with a correlator which has the same PN sequence, but at a rate which is delta R less than RC. So in here, chip rate is RC. In here, chip rate is RC minus delta R. That simple thing. What it does is this output would be like autocorrelation function, samples of this autocorrelation function, because I'm sampling that. Okay? Now, these samples are, what is the sampling rate? What is the repetition time? Those are the ones that I showed you with the calculation. These are what I showed you in here, basically in this figure. I showed you like this. With that correlator, you can calculate like roughly RC over delta R samples, and then your measurement time is like this K multiplied with one period from here to here. And then tau sub S, distance between two samples, basically is T sub S divided by K, in a sense. That's a simpler way to do it. Okay. Base of these pulses was like 2 times TC, or 2 over, 2 times TC, or 2 over RC. Okay? The conclusion that we got in here, maybe in 5 minutes of the, I think it took about 1 hour to explain a sliding correlator. Maybe 5 minutes of that was why it's used in the like measurement systems, for channel measurements. The rest was like detail of implementation and how direct sequence spread spectrum works. Now, remember that now. The important thing in here is you are doing the measurement in this manner one impulse response over like many times more than one period of the sequence. In the time response system, if I send this thing in here and I receive it in here, so I have one profile every TS second. But in here, if I use a sliding correlator, I have one profile every K times TS. And that K could be like 10,000. So I calculate really 10,000 times slower than what? Than pulse transmission technique. Okay? That's the difference. But the implementation is very simple. And my coverage will be better because the amplitude of the pulse that I send, the ratio of the peak power to average power in here is much better than ratio of the peak to average in pulse transmission technique. So with the same amplifier, I can go longer distances. Now, as I told you, a sliding correlator is not only used in the measurements, it's used for many, many synchronization things. Anytime that you want, you have plenty of time to do the autocorrelation function, like in GPS, you use a sliding correlator type of thing. So it's a very, very helpful receiver to learn about it. But it's not good for bit by bit detection of the bits because it takes so many, like 10,000 times more to calculate. But it's good for synchronization. If I have an OFDM signal, for example, they have the signal at the beginning, they have some synchronization. Like PN sequences they send for synchronization. That synchronization I can do a sliding coil. That's one way. There are other ways to do that too. Okay. Or if I have like a bunch of like Bluetooth terminals and they want to synchronize with one another, they synchronize through PN sequence, which is embedded inside the packets that they are transmitting. So Bluetooth is very slow actually for synchronization. They synchronize very, very slowly because a sliding correlator is very simple. Low power, but very slow. And with that, I finish this part. And when we come back, we start the third part of this lecture, which is frequency domain measurement techniques.